My name is Marco Pistoia. This is a joint work, I'm presenting joint work that I did with Paulina Centonze from Iona College and Omer Tripp, a colleague of mine from IBM Research. The goal of this work was to present a static analysis for computing the permissions needed by a Java program and also by the users executing that program. So in general, in the past, Java programs ran with a permission model that checks what permissions are needed by the code running. But in addition to that, programs can also run under the authority of a user, or, for example, the authority of a process. A user or a process are known as subjects. And this is true not only for Java, but also for the Microsoft.NET Common Language Runtime. So what permissions are needed by Java programs and what permissions are needed by the users of those programs in order to execute without security exceptions, and at the same time, in order to execute without granting too many permissions. So we want to have a policy, a security policy that doesn't grant too many permissions, in which case it would violate the principle of least privilege, and doesn't grant too few permissions, in which case the program will not run. The motivation of this work was to enable an application server, IBM WebSphere application server consisting of more than 2 million lines of code, to have a security policy that accounted not only for the code, but also for the users of the code. And as a result of this work, IBM WebSphere application server passed the common criteria evaluation assurance level 4 certification. So it was the evaluation of this work was performed not only by us at IBM, but also by the common criteria organization. So let me give you a quick overview of the Java security model. What happens at runtime is that every time there is a security-sensitive operation, for example, in this case, it's called the create socket, which calls the constructor of the socket library. Eventually, there is a call to us, the security manager. You can see here the instance is called SM, security manager, in which case we have the call to check connects. Then there is a call to check permission, and finally a call to access controller check permission. This API verifies that all the callers on the stack have the permission to execute the security sensitive operation, in this case the opening of a socket. The problem is to identify what permissions the code needs at runtime and what permissions the users will need at runtime. It's also possible for code to be on two stacks of execution. For example, in this case, we have a call to the socket constructor and a call to the file output stream constructor, which we can depict as follows. So we have first one stack which the socket constructor is called. In this case, we need a socket permission. And so all the callers on the stack will be demanded that particular socket permission. But we also have a caller to the file output stream constructor, which is another security sensitive operation. In this case, all the callers on the stack will need the permission to open the file output stream. So we have some code here that needs permission Q, some code that needs permission P, and some code that needs both P and Q. Let's look at this code here. You see that we have, again, a call to the socket permission and a call to the file, a call to the socket constructor and a call to the file output stream constructor. But in reality, granting both the socket permission and the file permission to the application code would be too much, would be a violation of the principle of least privilege. The reason is the following. The application code is asking to create a new socket. And as you can see from this, the application code is demanding a new socket, but the library that opens the socket is also logging the operation to a file. So if we granted both the socket permission and the file permission to the library and to the application code, this would be a violation of the principle of least privilege, because the application code doesn't really need to log to a file. If we gave the permission for logging to the application code, that permission could be misused. So that's why we have here this call to access controller do privileged that is used to prevent the stack inspection mechanism from reaching the application code. So to present this graphically, we see that on the left side, we have the call to the socket constructor that requires the permission to open the socket. Let's call this permission Q. And on the right-hand side, we have the call to open the file output stream. But this call is preceded by this API called the doPrivileged. So when doPrivileged is called, the stack inspection mechanism stops at the caller of doPrivileged. So all the code on the stack up to the caller of doPrivileged requires, is demanded the permission to open the file output stream. But the above that call, that permission will not be demanded. So for example, we see in this case that the client application will not be demanded to have the permission to write to the log file. So all these things are necessary in Java and in Microsoft.NET, but they're also, it's now necessary to model them statically. In addition to this model that grants permissions to code, we also have the ability to grant permissions to subjects. As I said before, a subject is a user or a process executing the code. A subject is actually the union of several principles. So, for example, a user can have, like in this case, we have a principle, X500 principle, and also a Kerberos principle. So let's take, for example, a general human being, a person. This person can be authenticated with his or her user ID and password, with the social security number, with a certificate. So there can be several authentication mechanisms that are used to authenticate a person. And based on the authentication used to authenticate that person, we can grant different permissions. For example, we can say that an authentication based on a digital certificate is stronger than an authentication based on a user ID and password, so the permissions granted when somebody authenticates with a certificate can be stronger. Permissions are added to the stack of execution is in the following way. So for example, if a stack is executing, there is a call to an API called the subject.doAs. There is also another API called the doAsPrivilege that I will mention later. At that point, the permissions granted to the subject S, in this case the instance is called the subject, are propagated downwards. When the stack inspection mechanism is activated and all the callers on the stack are demanded a particular permission, the permissions granted to the code or to the subjects will have to be there. So in other words, in this case we have that all for the four frames on the top of the stack, the code must be granted permission P. And for the for the bottom three frames, the code doesn't necessarily require permission P, because that code will be executed under the authority of a subject that already has permission P. So we can pretty much gray out the requirement for permission P on the code and just give it to the subject. It's actually very important to answer these questions that you see here. So number one, we need to understand which code is executed under the authority of which subject, and Also, given that we can now grant permissions to both subjects and code, we want to avoid a redundancy. We want to avoid a situation in which both the subject and the code are granted the same permissions, because again, the granting of permissions must be minimal. Otherwise, we violate the principle of least privilege. It's also, I'm sorry. I knew that I left something running. So it's also possible for multiple subjects to be active at the same time. So we have, I apologize for this inconvenience. Okay, so I was mentioning before, it's possible for multiple subjects to be active at the same time. So imagine a situation in which we have two calls to subject do as. In one case, we have subject as, and the other case, subject t. So there are two security sensitive operations being performed. And so in the left hand case, permission queue is checked. So whenever a stack inspection is performed, all the callers on the stack will have to exhibit permission queue. And so when a stack inspection is performed, you see that the permission queue will be required of all these stack frames. And we also have another call to check permission with permission P. In this case, the permission P will be demanded of all the callers on the stack as well. So we have some callers that will be demanded two permissions, P and Q. Now, suppose that subject S is granted both permissions P and Q, whereas subject T is only granted permission P. So in this case, the permission P and Q, the permissions P and Q will be propagated downwards, because that's exactly what the subject do as does. And in the other case, on the right-hand side, it's only going to be permission P that will be propagated downwards. So at this point, we see that we have some stack frames that are granted both permissions P and Q, and others that are granted only permission P based on the subjects executing the code. And at the same time, we also see that some of the callers on the stack will be demanded both permissions P and Q, whereas others will be demanded only P or only Q. So it becomes very challenging at this point to detect which permissions should be grayed out, in the sense that we don't need to grant that those permissions to the code, because they're already being granted to the subject. So the question is the following. Remember that every time you grant permissions to the code, those permissions are automatically granted to all to the program. So include whatever subject is executing that program, that subject will receive the permissions granted to the code. So granting permissions to the code is more risky than granting permissions to the subjects. So we want to eliminate permissions from the code so that the security policy is more restrictive. As I mentioned before, subjects are granted permissions based on the principles. So I gave you before the example of the social security number or the password or the certificate. So we need to understand where these permissions are added to the callers on the stack of execution. So the first thing that we do is we identify callers to do as. And the other API that I didn't describe yet is called the do as privilege, but I will describe that later. So at this point, the caller to do as takes a, as you remember, takes a subject parameter. So we need to take the subject instance. Statically, we identify the allocation in which the subject was instantiated. We look at the We look at the principles that populate that subject. We look at the permissions granted to those principles, and then we compute the union of all those permissions. So we call these sets, in this case, for example, P1, P2, and P3. And then we propagate these these sets forward, and we perform an intersection at the joints. So we basically cast this into a Jenkill problem, which is very simple. And you can see that whenever we have a call to do privilege, do as, or do as privilege, we basically kill. Otherwise, we perform a set intersection, as is shown here. So basically, we propagate, for example, P1 forward, but we kill at this level. We propagate the P3 forward, we propagate P2, and then we perform a set intersection in the joints. So this gives us an annotation of the call graph. And this annotation basically tells us what permissions are going to be given to the code as a result of being executed by a subject. It's also important to detect one thing that we found during this work was that some code was written poorly, basically. And so there were calls made to these APIs, say do as or do as privileged, that didn't require any permission. So why did the developers bother to even call those APIs? It's a security violation. So as soon as we detected that there was a call to one of these APIs that was labeled with the empty set, we basically flagged it as a redundant call. And so in this case, the code had to be rewritten, and the call to do as had to be eliminated. So we created a call graph, a particular algorithm. Basically, we created a solution that is path insensitive, because we wanted to account for multi-threaded code, flow sensitive for local variables, because we account for intra-procedural strong updates, but flow insensitive for fields. Again, because we want to account for multi-threaded code, so we wouldn't be able to really disambiguate which code was executed first if multiple threads are running. Objects are disambiguated based on their allocation sites. This allows us to have a context sensitivity policy in the call graph similar to Agesen's Cartesian product algorithm, CPA. Which was published at ECOUP 20 years ago, but it is still a very useful algorithm for one particular reason. For example, suppose that, as you can see here in the two nodes that I'm representing here in this slide, suppose we have two calls to check permission, one with permission P and the other one with permission Q. And P and Q are different. If we did not disambiguate these two call graph nodes, we would have just one node in which we would conservatively say that the parameters can be the set PQ. But this would be too conservative, because it wouldn't allow us to disambiguate these two nodes and to propagate the requirements for permission P from the requirement for permission Q. So distinguishing nodes based on the parameters and the receiver is actually very important for our security analysis. We also augmented the analysis with a solution that automatically creates a model for native methods. This is work that we published at ISTA 2006, and we augmented for this particular work. So basically, native methods in Java are written in C, and we created a translation tool that translates C into Java code. Of course, the Java code that we generate is not executable, but it is compilable. And from an analysis perspective, it models exactly what the C code does. We also have a string analysis that we published at ISTA 2011. And the string analysis is important because a permission object in Java contains two strings. For example, the file permission a file permission has two strings associated with it. The first string is the name of the file, and the second string is like a set of actions. For example, open, delete, or append. So we need to make sure that we have the ability to disambiguate these string constants. And that's why we have created a string analysis that during the analysis time computes the values of these strings. I would like to present the evaluation. As I mentioned before, this work was used to port an IBM application server, IBM WebSphere application server, to fully support subjects and to pass the common criteria evaluation assurance level 4 certification. So the application server consisted of more than 2 million lines of code. In particular, it consisted of 348 libraries. Our analysis had zero false negatives according to a very thorough evaluation performed by both maybe more than 20 developers who looked at the analysis results very thoroughly, and also by the Common Criteria organization. And we had a rate of false positive of 5%. In order to analyze each library, we took an average time of 103 seconds. I wanted to show you basically how complex the analysis was, but also at the same time how useful it was to have this tool, because basically the original work that the developers were trying to do was completely manual. So they took these 2 million lines of code and they started to look at this code manually, like staring at the code, trying to understand where to call duez, access controller check permission, what permissions to grant, and so on. So when we were called, IBM Research was involved in this work, we saw that of those 348 libraries, you can see in the first table, 105 libraries had no policy whatsoever. So the developers had not even defined a policy for those libraries. On the other hand, 141 of those libraries had only policies that accounted for the code, and 102 libraries had a policy that accounted for both code and subjects, but it was completely manually built. So we ended up computing all the permissions that were needed. As you can see in the last column, for example, we computed 143 permissions for the first set of libraries, 191 for the second set, 151 for the third set. And in addition, in some cases, we found that some of the permissions that the developers had manually computed were redundant. In other cases, were insufficient. So it was a lot of work that became possible only because we had an automated tool, because the amount of because the application server was really very large. We also computed a total of 263 principal of least privilege violations, which means that too many permissions had originally been granted, and the 219 insufficient policies, which means that in 219 cases, the policies were not sufficient to run the program and would have generated security exceptions at runtime. So there were also 14 unnecessary and redundant calls to these libraries, like do privilege, do as, and do as privileged. So this concludes my talk, and I would be happy to get your questions.
Hello. Good. So the Java Stack Introspection security model has been repeatedly criticized for vulnerability to confuse deputy attack. I was wondering if there was anything about this work that either tries to address the vulnerability or tries to detect the vulnerability.
Yes, so it is actually true. The Stack Inspection model is unsound because it only accounts for the current stack of execution. So if code previously ran influence the heap, for example, and that code is no longer on the stack, but now the values on the heap are used in the kernel stack of execution, nobody can track the permissions anymore. So unfortunately, we didn't have the authority to change the Java permission model, because I did work with two researchers, Anindo Banerjee and David Naumann, and in 2007 we published a paper at the IEEE Symposium on Security and Privacy in which we corrected the Java security model and we accounted for the unsoundness. And also I worked with Avi Shinar on making the work even more extensive. We published it at PLUS 2009, I think, right, Abby?
Another question, if I may. If anybody else is raising their hand, we should give them the mic. Okay. So one of the things that's wonderful about lexical scoping is that something that you can do now, something a piece of code can do now, by creating a lexical closure, which Java now supports well, you can capture the current context to postpone the activity and then be able to do the activity using the captured context later. With regard to the permissions context, does a lexical closure have any ability to capture its current stack-based permission context such that when executed later, it can use the permissions it has by virtue of what had been its call stack when it was created?
Yes, I think what happens is that the permissions at the time of creation are granted to that particular code, and then during the stack inspection, the stack traversal will look at those permissions.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
Thank you. Any other questions? And while the next speaker sets up the laptop, one final question for me. So your setup was that IBM researchers verified afterwards. Is the end goal that the application developers will use your tool?
Oh, yes. So we created the tool, and then the application developers evaluated the work, and also the Common Criteria organization evaluated the work as well, because they had to grant us the certification. So we created the tool and we collaborated in the evaluation, but the real evaluation was performed by the developers, because even the evaluation was prohibitive for us. Like, we were a small team of researchers, but like there were about 20 developers who performed the evaluation with testing, manual inspection of the results, and so on.
Let's thank Marco.
Thank you.